Wow, I love worshiping with you. Which means that you must be ready to hear from the Lord. So you ready to jump into God's word? Let's do it. Let's do it. Well, back on December 17th, 1927, it was a treacherous day at sea. As a U.S. Navy submarine was finishing up its practice mission off the coast of Massachusetts. And as it rose to the surface, something terrible happened. It was struck by another ship. And within just moments, the submarine, with all of its crew inside, sank to the bottom of the ocean floor. Now, immediately, a rescue mission went underway, but because of the terrible weather, it made getting to the men trapped in the submarine nearly impossible. But eventually, would-be rescuers made their way to the sub to discover that there were six sailors who were still alive. And eventually, those men tapped a message in Morse code to their would-be rescuers, and they asked this: "Is there any hope?" And the response that they received said, "There is hope. Everything possible is being done." And for many of us, this last year felt like getting struck, didn't it, by life. Whether it was through the loss of a job, the loss of a loved one, e-learning, sports seasons canceled, college plans abandoned, marriage tension, or old patterns rearing their ugly heads, or maybe just simply the loss of what we knew to be normal. For many of us, this last year, it has felt like we were sinking. But I'm sure there are also others of us who would say, no, this last year I felt like I went completely under. And so whatever your situation, as the calendar turns to this new year, you're likely asking the same question that those sailors did. Is there any hope? But if we're looking for hope, then we need to then ask, well, where does hope come from? The world says that it can offer hope, that everything possible is being done. Maybe hope is through a new vaccine or through a new job, or maybe just as simple as the turn in the page of the calendar. And listen, all of those things are good. But will they bring the lasting hope that we're longing for? You see, we don't need temporary fixes. We need long-term solutions. We need hope for the deeper issues that these life circumstances we're enduring are exposing. We need hope for those among us who are discouraged, weary, or cynical from living in this dysfunctional world. Those whose Christian lives feel like constantly running up a descending escalator, they need hope. Hope is needed for those who find themselves thinking, how is it that I could mess up that bad again? And for those who have this increasing suspicion that God's patience is wearing really thin. Where is hope for those who suspect that God loves them, but is probably deeply disappointed, or who wonder, have I shipwrecked my life beyond repair? Where is hope for that? Well, good news. Good news, church. Go ahead and grab your Bibles and let's go to 1 Peter chapter 1 for this first message for 2021. And through the three verses that we're going to look at, we're going to find three promises that will confirm that real hope is available for you today. And as you're turning there, can I just acknowledge something? That laundry list that I just walked us through, that was really hard to review through the list of reasons why we need hope. And I'm sure it wasn't easy to hear either, was it? But it's the reality of the place that we've been, or for some of you still may be. And here's why we need to bring that out into the open, so that regardless of the circumstances that may come your way, you can know, and this is the title to our message, that there is hope in a new year. So before we jump in to 1 Peter, let's do a little background check on this little book, starting with the author. 1 Peter was written by, you're brilliant and clearly awake, so good job. But before we race past who the author of Peter was, I want us to remember that this is the same Peter who in one moment said, Jesus, I'll stand with you to the death, and then not too much later denied his Jesus three times. But this is also the Peter who Jesus gloriously redeemed. And here's why that's important. Because we're going to hear from a man who isn't giving us spiritual platitudes written from an ivory tower. We're getting an authentic testimony about God's desire to redeem. And I believe that's a message that someone here today needs to hear. So back to 1 Peter, this letter was likely written to Christian refugees who had had to flee from Rome because they were being persecuted for their faith. And so picture the scene. There's a group of Christians, refugees, in a foreign land, struggling to make life work, suffering because of their faith in the Lord. And they're wondering, is there any hope? And what Peter will tell them, and today will tell us, is that everything possible was done through Jesus Christ. There is hope. And with that, let's pray. Father, I just invite you now to come even more than you already are into this room by your Spirit at work, through your word, through this messenger, God. May I please just fade to the background, and may you come forward and speak through us, to us through your word, applying it to our lives so that we are changed for your glory. In Jesus' name I pray, amen. Well, I've asked my friend Manuel Velasquez to come up today. He's going to read God's word over us. And here's why I've asked him to do that. Did you know that at every service, members of our Spanish ministry team translate the entire service for our Spanish brothers and sisters? And now that we live in a community that is well over 50% Hispanic, I thought it was just right, come on up here, brother, to have you read 1 Peter 1, 3 through 5 for us. You can follow along in English in your Bibles, or the verses will be on the screen as well. So again, 1 Peter 1, 3 through 5 in Spanish. Manuel, please.
Primera de Pedro 1, del 3 al 5 dice, Bendito el Dios y Padre de nuestro Señor Jesucristo, que según su grande misericordia nos hizo nacer para una esperanza viva por la resurrección de Jesucristo de los muertos, para una herencia incorruptible, incontaminada e inmersesible, reservada en los cielos para nosotros, que somos guardados por el poder de Dios mediante la fe, para alcanzar la salvación que está preparada para ser manifestada en el tiempo postrero.
Amen. Amen. Thank you, Manuel. I love how Peter begins. He says, Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. Let me explain a few things about that first part of verse 3. First, in the original language, that word blessed was reserved for God alone. And the English language doesn't really do justice to the temperature that comes with that word in the original language. And so I'm hopeful that how we're going to approach this passage today that we're going to study will fill us with the right intensity to be able to join Peter in saying, Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. And so here's what we're going to do. After we take a moment to unpack each verse, verse 3, 4, and 5, we're going to follow the lead of this first part of verse 3. And we're going to come back and we're going to consider how with our lives we can bless the Lord our God. Sound good? So let's begin with now this first thought. I have hope. I have hope because of the means of my salvation. Bless the Lord. Now, I want us to get this, because one of the most important things about us, listen, is what comes to mind when we think about God. The means of your salvation begins right here when Peter says, according. According to God's abundant mercy for you. Abundant mercy, great in kindness, boundless in concern. And since mercy comes from the heart, that means that what we're seeing here is God's heart, his motives. And put it together now. God's motive for saving you, his heart for you, is most accurately described as merciful. Merciful. Charles Spurgeon said, "It is from the mercy of our God that all our hopes begin." Vertical Worship has put together a song about mercy, God's mercy, and so I've asked Andy to come out and sing a portion of it over you. The lyrics are going to be on the screen, and you can follow along, or perhaps you just want to close your eyes and let the reality of God's mercy just wash over you.
I once was lost, walked away. The road was dark, I could not see. My hope was gone, and the pain was real. But your mercy, you saw my steps, you felt my fear. Heard my cries, and you caught the tears. Arms open wide, you ran to me. With your mercy, your mercy, your mercy, I stand before my King and bow my heart to sing. You saved me and you raised me. You died so I could live. There's no greater love than this. Your mercy, your mercy.
God's mercy like that. Later in his letter, Peter said, Christ died for sins once for all, the righteous for the unrighteous, to bring you to God. Have you allowed God's mercy to bring you to God? If you sense God stirring, knocking in your soul right now, that's God's Holy Spirit drawing you to himself. What better way to start this new year than to be born again? And that leads to what God says, that God's abundant mercy does. It causes something supernatural to occur. Ask anyone who's witnessed the birth of a child, and they'll use words like awesome, miraculous. That's why this is such an important metaphor to embrace. To be born again is describing the spiritual life that God has given to those who, through the gift of faith that we receive from God, have turned and embraced Jesus Christ for salvation. It's what Paul talked about happening in 2 Corinthians 5:17. Therefore, if anyone is in Christ, he is a new creation. And get this, This new birth, it is thoroughly God who does it. And in the same way that it's impossible to undo our physical birth, that means it's impossible for us to undo the new birth, the new life that we receive from God through Jesus Christ. Born again into God's family. A family that is known for, what does the text say? A living hope. A living hope, not a futile hope, as we learned last week from Pastor Eddie, that's based on religion or tradition, not a rational hope that strangles, not a rational faith that strangles hope, but it's based on the way of Jesus, rooted in faith, filled with hope. Here's how we define that. Hope, the confident expectation that God will keep his promises for the present and the future. But I know what you're thinking. Brit, people make promises all the time that they can't keep. And you would be right. And so how is it that we can be sure that what Peter is promising God will do for us will really happen? Well, watch for it now. Look at the end of verse 3. Through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead. Hope is ever living because Jesus Christ is ever living. That's why we make such a big deal about Easter. Get ready. Here it comes. He is. That's right. And little side note, if you're like I was and just uninformed, or maybe you're skeptical about Jesus Christ's resurrection from the dead, then I want to encourage you to check out this book. It's called More Than a Carpenter by Josh McDowell. And I read it, transformed my thinking, provided all the evidence, all the facts that I needed to be able to believe in the most important event that's ever occurred in human history. If that would be a blessing to you, I commend you to read it this month. All right. Long time ago, we took our family on a trip to Disney World when our kids were really young, which meant that we needed to come up with some really cool way to share the exciting news. And then on the day of the big reveal, anticipation flooded my heart as I pictured joyful children circling the room like little angels, rejoicing in the goodness of their mom and dad. And the camera was rolling, and I was sure this was going to go viral. And that is not at all how it went. When they opened the boxes that we had given to them and they took out the Mickey hats, their young minds just couldn't make the connection. What they thought we had done was given them mouse hats. Instant letdown. But after a little explaining, they got it. Mickey hats on, shouts of joy, angels were rejoicing. What had happened? They had come to understand their gift, were filled with hope and overflowing with joy. And you know what? That's just a silly picture of what this scripture could mean for you. Maybe you came here today not fully aware of, or had grown cold to the hope that you have in Christ, hope that comes from God's abundant mercy for you. Born again into a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ. And now that you know the means of your salvation, the natural response, as we see it in the first part of verse 3, is to join with Peter in saying, "Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ." And so, how do you do that? How do you cultivate an ongoing, growing heart to bless the Lord? Let's get really practical. Four ways to cultivate a heart to bless God. Number one, change. Your relationship with Jesus is just that, a relationship. And just like We like to do different things with the people we like hanging out with. Bring some variety to your walk with Christ. On the days when you're wanting to get into God's Word, sometimes read it. Other days, study it. When it comes time to pray, sometimes pray in your room. Other days, go on a walk and pray. When it comes to worship, sometimes read a psalm. Other times, get in your car, turn on the radio, and crank the volume and worship your face off. And then, creativity. Did you know that technology can stir up worship in your heart? Whether it's on Spotify, Pandora, iTunes, start to put together a playlist that you can use to go and worship the Lord. And somehow, through the miracle of technology, those apps will start sending you more music that you'll like. And if you have no idea what I'm talking about right now, then please just go to your nearest teenager or millennial, and I'm sure they'd love to help you, okay? And then cut. Now, I know I just said to use technology. But statistics are showing that the average American spends at least up to 700 hours on their devices, texting, posting, searching, liking. And so, what if we took measures this year to cut down on the distractions and allowed God to touch our hearts even just a fraction of the time that we touch our phones? And finally, creation. David said in Psalm 19 that the heavens declare the glory of God. And so, take a look at the sky sometime and look up and praise God that as high as the heavens are above the earth, so high is his love for you. Or take in the horizon sometime and worship Christ that as far as the east is from the west, so far as he removed your transgressions. Or, and I know this will be hard for us in Illinois, lift your eyes up to the hills and thank God that your help comes from the one who made them. Well, one thing that a lot of people did on Google in 2020 was search. And the word that was the most searched for word was death, which tells me that people are looking for hope. And the good news is that when you've been born again, and this leads to our next lesson, I have hope because of the results of my salvation. Bless the Lord. Let's go back to verse 3, and now we're going to read all the way through verse 4. We've been born again to a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead, to an inheritance that is imperishable, undefiled, and unfading, kept in heaven for you. Here's what Peter is saying. Because of the living hope that you have in Christ, you can look forward with confidence to receiving an inheritance. Now, Peter, he doesn't go into a lot more detail about this inheritance, but he does use three powerful words to describe it. He says, your inheritance is imperishable. It will never decay. Your inheritance is undefiled. It's forever pure. And your inheritance is unfading. It never loses its immaculate character. But here's one thing that comes to my mind when I hear about such a priceless inheritance. Is anyone guarding it? We'll look back in the text. Peter says that your inheritance is kept. Where? In heaven, meaning by God, far beyond the reach of the awful hardships of this world. And the inheritance is being kept for you. Did you notice the subtle shift that just happened? Up to this point, Peter's been using plural words like us and our, but here, talking about your inheritance, he went personal. He's talking to you. Listen, this is no Ponzi scheme. This is no hyped-up salesman over-promising only to under-deliver. And in case the trials that you're enduring these last several months might be tempting you to think that God doesn't love you or is for some reason going to renege on his promise, Numbers 23:19 says this about God, that he is not a man that he should lie. He's not like a son of man that he should change his mind. Does he speak and then not act? Does he promise and not fulfill? Late last year, Renee's mom went home to be with the Lord. And shortly after, we received many gorgeous bouquets of flowers. And every day we saw them, it was so comforting to see their beauty, but it wasn't long before you could tell that those beautiful flowers were now beginning to fade, and eventually it was time to throw them away. Maybe the message that you need to hear today is that that will never happen to your inheritance. And isn't that moving you to want to join with Peter in saying, "Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ"? And so how can you do that? When I think of an inheritance, I think of preparation. For example, if I was to receive a financial inheritance, I'd probably open some accounts and secure some advisors to make sure that we were prepared, ready. And so it makes sense that for this spiritual inheritance that we're going to receive one day, we want to do all that we can to make sure that we're ready for that day when the Lord says, "Here." So here's some simple ways that we can do that this year. Let's start with your view of God and your view of the gospel. Maybe it needs a little sharpening, because after all, what you think about God and your grasp of the gospel, as I said earlier, they're so, so important. And so consider reading one or both of these books that I'm going to show you. The first is a book by Dane Ortlund called Gentle and Lowly, Christ's Heart for Sinners and Sufferers. And then pick up this one, little book. You can use it as a way to prime the pump. No pun intended when you see the title. It's called The Gospel Primer by Milton Vincent. God has used these two resources in mighty ways in my soul. And I'd love for that God to do the same in yours. And then I know that last year tried to do everything it could to assault our marriages, our families, our finances, emotions, even our faith, which is why I'm so excited about those hope classes that Lynn told you about earlier today. And if you need a boost of hope to help you continue growing as a man of God, as a woman of God, no matter your age, in any one of those areas that you see, then please go to harvestnow.info today to learn more and to sign up. So we've learned that you have a living hope because of the means of your salvation, and it's an inheritance that will never spoil. And now in verse 5, Peter considers whether we will in fact receive this inheritance. And you know what? I'm terrible at keeping surprises, so let's just go to this last point, okay? And see that I have hope because of the permanence of my salvation. I have hope because of the permanence of my salvation. Bless the Lord. And let's do this. Let's springboard into verse 5 by saying together the last word in verse 4. It starts with a Y and ends with a U. You got it? Here we go. 1, 2, 3. And look at what Peter says in verse 5 that God does for you who believe in Christ. He guards. That means that God, with his creation-making, universe-upholding, death-defeating power, he's got you. He has you. But maybe you're thinking, 2020? And so what Peter's getting at must mean something other than God protecting us from threats, right? Well, for the record, God can and often does protect us from danger. But here, Peter, what he's done is identified that God promises to fortify you from ever falling away from him or the salvation that you've received from Christ. It's a present tense word, which means he's always on guard. He's always on patrol. And notice that Peter says that you have a role in this. And what is it? To believe. Have faith. But I want to caution you. This was big for me. You shouldn't see this as some sort of transaction, as though you're hiring God through your faith to be your spiritual bodyguard. No. Your faith is the result of being guarded, not the other way around. Picture it like this. In John chapter 10, verse 28, Jesus said, "I give them eternal life, and they will never perish, and no one will snatch them out of my hand." This coin right here represents you and your salvation. And my right hand represents Jesus. And what Jesus has just declared is that no one or no thing could ever snatch you out of his hand. But then Jesus says in verse 29 of John chapter 10, "My Father who has given them to me, he's greater than all. And no one is able to snatch them out of my Father's hand." And so it wasn't enough that Jesus has you and your salvation firmly in his grasp. Now he's saying that the Father has you too. Amen. That's why you could experience the blessings of your inheritance in the present and be completely confident in your salvation in the future. Rescued from God's future judgment, delivered from this world into heaven, because Jesus' death, his resurrection, and his ascension have made this salvation a reality, and the text says that it's ready. Hallelujah. And so what does a life look like that's free to enjoy that kind of confidence in the future? Well, it's a life that seeks out ways to bless the Lord, get this, by blessing others. Recently, I was at a funeral where the family testified about their mother, that the model that she came to be known by was, "How can I be a blessing to someone today?" In a season when hope is in high demand, and now that you know that you have lots of that hope, what if you made it your aim in 2021 to bless others with hope? One group of people that you could do that with would be your Christian brothers and sisters. Like you, they're trying so hard to make it one day at a time through this terrible world. And so what if you made it your aim to share through an email, a text, a post, maybe even a letter in the U.S. mail, a hope-filled promise from God's word or a heart-filled prayer? Imagine the wave of hope that we would be riding if we did that for one another. And then, we all know at least one person who hasn't yet embraced Jesus for salvation, right? And I want you to just think for a moment about what 2020 must have been like for them, apart from the hope of Christ. And so who's the one life, the one life that this year you could pray for, serve, encourage with your testimony, and even one day share the gospel with, so that they could come to know the same hope that you and I are privileged to know? As you bless others, You're blessing the Lord. Is there any hope? It's what the sailors in that submarine were crying. And the assurance they got was, there is hope. Everything possible is being done. And it's 2021. It's a new year now, and there's a lot about the future that we just don't know. But what we do know is that we have hope in a new year because everything possible was done by God, the same God that a multitude in heaven will worship for eternity with a loud voice crying out, salvation belongs to our God. Amen? So blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ for the means of our salvation, the results of our salvation, and the permanence of our salvation. And Andy and the worship team are coming now to lead us in worship. And as we do that, you've been leaning in all morning. And I want you to lean in once again. And I want you to give this everything you got. And I want you to try to do two things at once here right now. And I believe in you. I think you could do it. And it's going to be so worth it. As you're singing these songs, the words to this song, I want you to be thinking, picturing the words from 1 Peter that we just heard. Born again, to a living hope, to an inheritance, kept in heaven for you, for a salvation ready to be revealed. Are you ready? Go ahead and stand, and let's bless the Lord.